You this morning in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The body of Christ has come together this morning to celebrate the greatness of our God. A couple of bulletin highlights. Take time to read your bulletins. There's a lot of great information in there. One of them is an international student freshman dinner coming up. We get international students from all over the world to come to Lehigh University. And here's our opportunity to be able to pour into their lives the gospel of Jesus Christ. If you were interested in being a part of that, this is what you can do. You can make a meal. We need 9 people to volunteer to make a meal for this event. If you want to do that, there's an online sign up for that to let people know you're going to do that, and you need to bring that meal next Sunday and put it in the church fridge. The next announcement is the outdoor service. This is our 3rd annual outdoor service and picnic. Great event. Well attended, we love it. It's a great time that we come together, the fellowship. But we want you to use this as an opportunity to outreach to other people. Invite your neighbors, invite your friends, invite your family to come. It's a great outreach event as well. That'll be on September the 10th at 10:30 a.m. One service with the picnic to follow. And then the final announcement, the highlight, is baptisms are coming up on August the 27th. If you are interested in being baptized, see Pastor Tim and he will direct you accordingly. Now we have a ministry moment on the Costa Rican trip by Karen Cauldron. I'm sorry.
Well, you're an awesome group. You know, when it's freezing in January and you're longing for the warm days of summer, I have an idea for you. Why not join the combined mission trip from Ebenezer and Coopersburg to tropical Costa Rica with cool nights and warm days on January 18th through the 26th. This team is going to Heredia, Costa Rica to help missionary Lillian Soltz in assisting with construction group or projects, participate in children and youth projects, worship in a couple of churches, experience a new culture, and bonding with members of the team. From personal experience, going on mission trips is probably one of the most memorable times of my life. I've probably been on about 15 mission trips in about 5 different countries. There's no greater joy than helping others and serving them with your time and your effort. No experience is needed. The thing is, if I can sand, paint, stain, clean off graphite from 16-foot poles, or whatever else they ask me to do, so can you. My request to you is to pray and seek God's guidance to consider in going on this team. If the Lord is leading, he will direct you in finding the time and the finances on going on this mission trip. Deadline is November 1st, and there's possibly going to be limited spots because of combining with Coopersburg, so we ask you to sign up early. If you have any questions or you're interested, contact Swanee Griffin. There's more information in the insert in your bulletin. Now, Isaiah said, I heard the voice of God saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for me? Then I said, here I am, send me. Are you the one God is calling? Thank you.
Amen. The Word of God says in Psalm 27, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. On whom shall I be afraid? There's a lot in our world today to be afraid of. The news is thrusting us with all this information about what we should be afraid of. But God is our light. We need not fear the darkness. God is our stronghold. He's our salvation. No matter what happens, he's in control, and we belong to him. So we've come this morning to celebrate, to praise, and worship his name. So let's do that. Let's stand here this morning. Before we do that, let's greet one another and welcome them this morning.
morning, church. We are a mighty fortress in our God. Let's sing it out, the mighty fortress that He is for us as we worship together.
Mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, He amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate, on earth is not His equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. You ask who that may be? Christ Jesus, it is He, the Lord of hosts, His name, from age to age the same. And He must win the battle.
Forever.
mighty and awesome in power. Let's sing of our God.
Water you turned into wine, and opened the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you. And into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise.
About that greatness and radiance. It says, long ago, at many times, in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. Think about this. Think, picture Jesus Christ in your mind. He is the radiance of the glory of God. He is the exact imprint of his nature. And he upholds the universe by the word of his power. After making purifications for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. That is the power of Jesus Christ, the majesty, the radiance, the glory of our God as we worship him. And that same power through the Holy Spirit lives within us, those who believe and who are called his children. Let's sing of that same power.
There is power in his name, for the stone was rolled. Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Mighty Savior, lifted high, King forever, Jesus Christ, and crowned in glory and raised to life. The same power lives in us. We will rise, stand and sing of our great and matchless King, seated high on the throne, who shall reign forevermore. You shall reign forevermore.
Sing, Mighty Savior.
Mighty Savior.
Always, always. is on the way.
And worship. Let's go before the throne room of God this morning in thanksgiving and praise to Him. Oh God, as we enter your presence this morning, we are mindful that there is no God but you. Your greatness, your glory, your majesty, your sovereign is second to none. You have no competition. You are over all. You are ruler of everything. And though we live in a world in which gives us frightening things every day, we become fearful of what we see as rogue nations rise up and defy us, and times we wonder if our norm is going to be changed, and that brings fear to us. And yet, because we are in Christ, you have a plan, a sovereign plan that includes both the destruction of evil and the glorification of your Son and His bride, the church. And so, Father, in the midst of fear, we can have hope, we can have joy, because we belong to you. We thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, that He is the preeminent one, that He is the exact imprint of the Almighty God, and that He took upon Himself flesh, and He lived a perfect life. He endured the hardships of this earth, and He took upon Him our sins, our despicable rebellions against you. And He died, and He took the wrath that we deserved upon Himself. But Father, He rose victoriously, and that great power of the resurrection, that name of Christ could not be held. He conquered death, not just for Himself, but for His church. that we in Christ will rise with him. And oh, Father, though this world is fading away and evil, and there's so many things about it that tempt us and try us, yet we can have the joy to know that we are in Christ, and that someday we will be in his presence forevermore. Old things will pass away. Behold, all things will become new. But Father, as we continue in this world, for it is your plan for us to continue, you have given us a responsibility to proclaim this great message, that the world may know that Christ has come to seek and to save the lost. Father, may we be faithful to do that. May we be faithful to live holy lives in the midst of evil. May we shine the light of Jesus Christ brightly. Father, I want to pray especially this morning for those who have different types of ailments, whether they be physical ailments, and they just get through hour after hour with their pain and their sorrows. Father, would you administer comfort to them? Because the same power that rose Jesus from the dead is within us to administer comfort, to help us to overcome sin. Father, would you comfort those who are in need this morning? Father, we think of those who have wayward children, and it breaks their hearts that their children are not following after you. Father, I pray that your Spirit would work in the hearts of these children, draw them to Jesus Christ, and they would be wonderfully saved, that they might have joy in knowing this. Father, I would pray for those this morning who may have lost a mate, whether through death or through divorce, and Father, I pray that you administer to them comfort. Father, you are the Almighty God who loves his children. Father, keep us close to you. Keep us from the distractions of this world, that we might honor and glorify you. Now, Father, help us to be able to pause in our thinking, pause in our distractions, and focus on you as you speak to us through your word. We pray that you would anoint Pastor Tim, fill him with your Spirit, that the words that would come forth would be the very words of God, and we would take them and receive them and have them transform our lives. We pray this in the precious name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 We want to welcome you again this morning. We are so thankful that the body of Christ has come together to fellowship and to worship together. We ask you to take the black pads, and if you would pass them down the aisles, you would take time to sign in legibly your names. We elders take that very, very seriously. We use that in our shepherding of the congregation. We'd also ask you to take an outline for this morning's sermon. And if you are a visitor with us this morning, we want to especially welcome you. We hope you feel welcome. And if you would take that visitor card out, and if you would sign that and put that in the offering plate or in the welcome center before you leave, we would greatly appreciate that. Now we are going to continue in our worship. This is not a pause in worship, a parenthesis. This is a continuance in worship as we give back to God a portion of what he's given to us in our tithes and offering. Men, would you come forward this morning?
Thank you. hope that your hearts are ready and prepared this morning to hear from God's Word. Open your Bibles to the book of Genesis, chapter 41. If you're visiting with us, we're working our way through some of the greatest stories of history. The story of Joseph, a story of providence which describes for us the sovereign God who sits in the heavens, as the scripture says in Psalm 115, verse 3, the God of the heavens sits there and he does what he pleases and he orchestrates all of our lives. If we're in Christ this morning, if we're believers, we know that all things work together for good to those who love him and are called according to his purpose. And our God is sitting in the heavens and he's doing what he pleases. That's a great truth to know when all things are going well. Easy to say, yes, we have a God who's working out all things for me. Look at how good my life is. Until things are not too good, and things are difficult, and there's death in your life, or a lost job in your life, or some difficulty in your life that you're facing, and then you have to step back and say, how in the world does Paul and Silas sing hymns in prison? How is it that we as Christians are different than everybody else in the world when North Korea makes claims that they're going to attack us? We sit back and say, oh, you can't do nothing. You can do nothing unless God allows it. How is it that we as Christians can have peace in the dungeon? The sovereignty of God and the providence of God is this great doctrine of God and his incredible power. That's not just some doctrine that fills our head full of knowledge about how wonderful and great God is. He is. But it's a doctrine, as we study the story of Joseph, that just helps us to unfold how we can have peace regardless of what comes our way. Last time we were together and we looked at chapter 40 of Genesis, we saw that Joseph was faithful in the dungeon. And we saw that in the midst of difficulties in life, no matter what comes our way, we as believers can hold on to the promises of God, that we cannot be rattled or derailed when unjust suffering comes our way, because we know that we know that we know that God is in control. And so we can be faithful. But what about being peaceful? What about having that rest in our souls when everything seems to fall apart and the world around us says, where is your God? And you say, oh, my God is sitting on the throne and I have a peace that surpasses all understanding. I have a peace that has guarded my heart and my mind in Christ Jesus. Can you do that this morning? Do you know God in that way? Have you come to a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus that no matter what comes your way, you can say, you know what? God is in control. He's sitting on his throne, and I have peace. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. This inward tranquility that you can rest in God. This morning we're going to be studying Genesis chapter 41. If you don't have a Bible, there's a pew Bible in front of you. I encourage you to turn to page 34. And this morning, as we unfold these stories and we talk about these stories, these are here for us. They're here for us as believers to teach us how to relate to our God. So I hope and pray that the Holy Spirit will speak to you. This morning, stand with me in honor of God's Word, Genesis chapter 41. We're not going to read all of it, but we'll read down to verse 40 or so. We'll stop as I see fit. We won't get to the whole story, but we'll talk about some of it today and some of it next Sunday. So follow along with me. Joseph is in prison. He's been there for a while. And God is working. Chapter 41, verse 1. And after 2 whole years, Pharaoh dreamed that he was standing by the Nile. And behold, there came up out of the Nile 7 cows, attractive and plump. And they fed in the reed grass. And behold, 7 other cows, ugly and thin, came up out of the Nile after them and stood by the other cows on the bank of the Nile. And the ugly, thin cows ate up the 7 attractive, plump cows. And Pharaoh awoke, and he fell asleep and dreamed a second time. And behold, 7 ears of grain, plump and good, were growing on one stalk, and behold, after them sprouted 7 ears, thin and blighted by the east wind. And the thin ears swallowed up the 7 plump, full ears. And Pharaoh awoke, and behold, it was a dream. So in the morning, his soul, his spirit was troubled. And he sent and called for all the magicians of Egypt and its wise men. Pharaoh told them his dreams, but there was none who could interpret them to Pharaoh. Surprise, surprise. Then the chief cupbearer said to Pharaoh, I remember my offenses today, when Pharaoh was angry with his servants and put me and the chief baker in custody in the house of the captain of the guard. We dreamed on the same night, he and I, each having a dream with its own interpretation. A young Hebrew was there with us, a servant of the captain of the guard. And when we told him, he interpreted our dreams to us, giving an interpretation to each man according to his dream. And as he interpreted it to us, so it came about, I was restored to my office and the baker was hanged. Then Pharaoh sent and called Joseph, and they brought quickly him out of the pit. And when he had shaved himself and changed his clothes, he came in before Pharaoh. And Pharaoh said to Joseph, I have had a dream, and there is no one who can interpret it. I have heard it said of you that when you hear a dream, you can interpret it. Joseph answered Pharaoh, it is not in me. God will give Pharaoh a favorable answer. Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, behold, in my dream I was standing on the banks of the Nile. 7 cows, plump and attractive, came up out of the Nile and fed in the reed grass. 7 other cows came up after them, poor and ugly and thin, such as I've never seen in all the land of Egypt. And the thin cows ate up the first 7 plump cows. But when they'd eaten them, no one would have known that they had eaten them, for they were still as ugly as at the beginning. Then I awoke. I also saw in my dream 7 ears growing on one stalk, full and good. 7 ears withered, thin, and blighted by the east wind, sprouted after them, and the thin ears swallowed up the 7 good ears. And I told it to the magicians, but again, there was no one who could explain it to me. Then Joseph said to Pharaoh, the dreams of Pharaoh are one. God has revealed to Pharaoh what he is about to do. The 7 good cows are 7 years, and the 7 good ears are 7 years. The dreams are one. The 7 lean and ugly cows that came up after them are 7 years, and the 7 empty ears blighted by the east wind are also 7 years of famine. It is as I told Pharaoh, God has shown to Pharaoh what he is about to do. Therefore will come 7 years of great plenty throughout all the land of Egypt. But after them there will arise 7 years of famine, and all the plenty will be forgotten in the land of Egypt. The famine will consume the land, and the plenty will be unknown in the land by reason of the famine that will follow, for it will be very severe. And the doubling of Pharaoh's dream means that the thing is fixed by God, and God will shortly bring it about. Now therefore let Pharaoh select a discerning and wise man and set him over the land of Egypt. Let Pharaoh proceed to appoint overseers over the land and take 1/5 of the produce of the land of Egypt during the 7 plentiful years, and let them gather all the food of these good years that are coming and store up grain under the authority of Pharaoh for food in the cities, and let them keep it. That food shall serve as a reserve for the land against the 7 years of famine that are to occur in the land of Egypt, so that the land may not perish through the famine. This proposal pleased Pharaoh and all his servants. And Pharaoh said to his servants, can we find a man like this, and whom is the Spirit of God? Let's stop right there. Bow your heads with me. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we love you. We thank you for your word. We're thankful that you always come through. Your promises are true. You're never late. Sometimes you're never early, but you're never late. And we know that you're with us and that you're working in our lives. We pray this morning you'll teach us how to be peaceful when all things seem to be falling apart in our life. And Father, if it's not happened yet, it will come. There will be days in all of our lives when the future may be discouraging, or the present may be distraughtful. And how will we stand? Will we sing hymns along with Paul and Silas in the dungeon and have a peace that surpasses all understanding? And will we hold that you are the God who sits in the heavens and does what you please, or will we fret like the rest of the world? Help us, O God, to learn so that our souls may be firm and stand firm in our faith. Bless now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Be seated. These stories are not just little children's stories that we tell in the Sunday school classroom so that they might learn biblical history. These are the stories that if you will, unfold for us the divine work of God and reveal to us something of the mystery of God's incredible power. And it's designed to give us strength and designed to give us an ability to rest in who God is. I'll be honest with you, most of us, we fret and we wallow in our own pity and we find ourselves when we're in the dungeon and we forget these great truths that it's God who is over all things. And these stories are designed to help us. They're designed to help us that instead of being in troubled in life, and yes, trouble will come, but we can put our hope in God and we can have a life of peace knowing that God is in control and that God is able. He's able to do whatever He wants to do. So this morning I want to help us to learn how to have peace, how to be peaceful in the dungeon. The world is watching us. The question is, are we any different than the world? Sometimes I fear we're not much different than the world. We allow the circumstances of our life to overwhelm us. Instead of just resting in God. Point number one is this. Peace comes by learning to be patient. Oh, don't check out on me on the first point. This is a difficult point. But peace comes by learning to be patient, knowing that God works out the details of life in His own timing. Notice the very first verse of chapter 41. In fact, you might underline it, circle it, put a star by it. After 2 whole years. Now, if you've not been with us, we've been studying the life of Joseph, and he's had such a horrible experience. His brothers threw him in a pit. He was probably around 14, 13, 14, 15, when he had a vision where God said that he would be this ruler, that he would have power, and that his brothers would come and bow before him. He had a couple of dreams. And the brothers were jealous of him and the coat that his father had given him. And you remember, they threw him in a pit. And then he ended up in slavery. The Ishmaelites carried him into Egypt, and he ended up in slavery, and Potiphar bought him, and he came second in command in Potiphar's house, and then Potiphar's wife accused him wrongly, and he got thrown into prison, and now he's been in prison for some time, maybe 2 years. We don't know if it's just 2 years after the cupbearer was released and restored to his position of authority. We don't know, but he's been here for a while. And if you count back all the years, you could say, well, if Joseph was 15 when he received those first dreams that God had given to him, showing him what was going to happen, he becomes around 30. If you look at chapter 41, verse 46, Joseph is actually 30 years old when he comes to power in Egypt. So that's about 15 years of difficulty, 15 years of trial. I don't know what it is about Christians, and we think that when we come to Christ and we become Christians, that automatically we just get to have everything instantaneous. We love our instant coffee. We love our instant hot chocolate. We love the microwave, you know, Sara Lee, whatever they are. I haven't eaten many of them. Stick them in the microwave and we have a meal within 30 seconds. And somehow we believe that that transfers over into our Christian life. And that somehow, and we saw this last time we were together, that we have to be careful that we're faithful in the dungeon and not be derailed when unjust suffering comes and when difficulty comes. And we have to know this, that listen, waiting sometimes is the hardest part in the Christian life. And yet for Christians, this is par and parcel for the course. Waiting is a part of being a Christian. Waiting on the Lord. The scripture is very clear. We're to wait on the Lord. Psalm 27, one of my favorite chapters in all the Bible. Why so downcast, O my soul? Oh, I would have despaired unless I would have known the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, verse 14 says, wait for Him. Wait patiently for Him. Be strong. Let your heart take courage. Yes, wait for the Lord. I asked my staff this last week, what do you think the purpose of chapter 40 was? We go back and we look at the story of chapter 40. There's not really much theological truth in that story. And we have to say, well, why in the world was the story of the cupbearer there? Why was the story of the baker there? Why were all those details laid out there for us? And I can only come to this conclusion. Listen, those details were there to show us how Joseph gets into the presence of Pharaoh. And it shows us very clearly that God is working, yes, even in the details of our lives. Some of you like that, some of you don't like that. And yet we have to rest in the Lord. Let me ask you this. Can you say this with Joseph, and can you say this with us as Christian? God knows best. Can you say, I know, God, that you know what is best for your children? And so I'm willing to wait on you. And I understand that nothing comes too late and nothing comes too soon. And you're working out all these things for your glory and for our good. Now let me give you three things to think about. Number one is this: expectations. God is not obligated to get you out of the dungeon. He's not obligated to do that because we're Christians. Margaret Thatcher, the British Prime Minister, said this: I'm extraordinarily patient, provided I get my own way in the end. And that's the way many of us live. I'll be patient as long as, God, you come through in my timing, when I want it, how I want it done. Listen, God is not obligated. He's not obligated. He's not a God who's there and is answering our beck and call. Yes, we pray by faith and ask God, but we always pray, my Father, not my will, but thy will be done. And so whatever you're facing, difficulties with your kids, difficulties with job, health issues, and the list goes on and on. You find yourself in a difficult place and you're crying out to God. Listen, God's not obligated. He may answer you in his due time. But is it not true that God may very well wait till you're gone and in glory before he answers the prayer for your salvation of your son, the salvation of your daughter, for reconciliation of some marriage or this or that or whatever it is? Listen, we got to be careful about our expectations. God is not obligated to get us out of the dungeon because we're Christians. Number two, timing. God will act according to his own plan and his own timing. You know, it's amazing, even in the details, how God works. I didn't get permission, but I don't think it's probably a problem. Yesterday was Allie Summons' wedding. And you know, I just love how God works in some of the details of our own lives. Apparently Lindsay Harkins, and I don't see Jeremy in here, but apparently Lindsay was working with some of the flowers and these kinds of things with the wedding. And she went over to Produce Junction, I think, which is over in Allentown. I've been there once or twice, and they've got beautiful flowers. They're fairly inexpensive and for the wedding and these kinds of things. But they didn't have their shipment in for that day, and so Lindsay apparently was kind of fretting a little bit, and, oh, what am I going to do? I'm going to have to go and find some flowers other places, and limited in funds and those kinds of things. You know how it is when you're putting a wedding together. She's limited in funds a little bit. She says, well, I guess I'll have to look around because they didn't have the flowers that she needed. So she goes back to the car only to find that she had locked her keys in the car. Locked her keys in the car. And I may not have all the details right, but you know, I don't know, I would have fretted. I don't know if she fretted. I don't know if she did or not, but she says, well, I'll go back in and wait, try to figure out how to get my keys back. Well, when she went back in, guess what? A new shipment had just arrived of flowers for the wedding that was here yesterday. God knew that. God knew that. God knows the details. In his timing, granted, they may come in the next moment. They may not come for another year. They may not come for a lifetime. But God will act according to his own plan and his own timing. We have no record of Joseph's bitterness here in the dungeon. But let me just challenge you. Guard your heart from bitterness. Guard your heart from saying to God, God, you're not answering me when I want an answer. God, why aren't you listening to me? Please answer me now, right? And there's a tendency of us all to be bitter, because we feel like God doesn't hear us. God is not answering us. It's very possible that God may wait. He may wait till we're gone. Then there's a third thing. Something to think about. God may leave us in the dungeon to be a place of molding, a place of training. My pastor used to tell me there's no wasted time in God's economy. God is working. God is planning. What is God doing for Joseph in those years as he's in dungeon? He's training him. He's preparing him. He's causing him to be dependent upon God. He's teaching him in the dungeon to be dependent upon God. You know, it's oftentimes it's only in the dungeons where we learn to be dependent upon God. We're not dependent upon God on the mountaintops. And maybe it's that God is purposely leaving us there to mold us and to train us, and definitely a place of testing. Colossians chapter 3, verse 12 says, put on patience. Put on patience. Trust in the Lord when your son or your daughter, your marriage or your job or whatever is struggling. Learn what God is trying to teach you in the midst of that training period. Because you have to be patient and wait on the Lord. See, I fear, brothers and sisters, that we're so much like the world, and that when trouble comes, we don't have peace. We don't have peace. Peace comes from just resting in God. God, I know you have a plan. I know you have a purpose. I'm holding on to you. I'm trusting in you in these things. I'm not expecting you to answer me, but I'm going to wait on you. I'm going to hope in you and trust in you, and God's promises never fail, and God answers in His due time. There's a second lesson. We're learning how to have peace in the midst of the dungeon. It comes by being patient, but secondly, number two, and I love this, it comes by learning to be confident. Confident that God has a real plan for your life and the world around you for His glory and for our good. In verses 2 through 16, we see these incredible dreams. Apparently, Pharaoh has some dreams. You remember the cupbearer has been restored to his place of authority. The baker has been hung in the previous chapter. Now 2 years have passed, and God in His specific timing has allowed Pharaoh to have some dreams. Interesting dreams about cows and about corn. I don't know if you ever had dreams about cows or corn. It's kind of interesting dreams. But in the days of Egypt, obviously cows and corn represent prosperity and security in Egypt. Bizarre dreams. And yet he has these dreams that there are these fat cows that are going to be eaten by skinny cows and fat corn that's going to be consumed by thin corn, blighted corn, eastern wind-blown blighted corn. He has these dreams, and if you'll notice with me, verse 8, underline this phrase. So in the morning his spirit was troubled. Pharaoh's spirit was troubled. Oh, that we wouldn't be troubled when things don't happen our way. So let me give you a couple things here to think about. Being confident that God has a plan, a real plan for your life and the world for His glory and for our good. So here's the first thing. Number one, when we're anxious, when we're troubled, don't go to the secular. What do I mean by that? Well, did you notice what Pharaoh does? He wakes up in the morning, he has these dreams, he doesn't know exactly what they are. And by the way, the dreams in Egypt were very much oriented around hieroglyphics, right? And these dreams, sorcerers, magicians, astrology was a real main part of Egyptian life. And so Pharaoh has these dreams. And notice what he does. He's troubled in his spirit. He's very troubled. And what does he do? He goes to his magicians. In fact, we see that here's the first thing that he does. He calls for the magicians of Egypt and all of its wise men. You remember when Moses stood before Pharaoh, you remember Pharaoh had wise men there and they would throw their rods down and make them into snakes as well. I would say very clearly here, these magicians are not godly magicians. They're of the devil. They have powers of the dark side. And so Pharaoh calls for them. He calls them. Can you come and interpret these dreams, right? Now, notice what I'm asking you not to do. When you're troubled, the tendency is to go everywhere except the place you should be going, to the Word of God, to the man of God, to the truth of God's Word. Go to the Lord. Go to the presence of the Lord. Inevitably, these people aren't going to understand the things of God. It shouldn't surprise us that these magicians in verse 8, there was none who could interpret them to Pharaoh. I think that's a great testimony about those who don't know Christ, those who are not of God. They don't know spiritual things. As Lewis Johnson said in one of his sermons one time, he said, I don't take credit for not everyone understanding or even being encouraged or embraced in the sermon, because these things are not spiritually appraised. These things are spiritually appraised. They're not naturally appraised. They're spiritually appraised. And so he says, I don't take credit for when unbelievers come into the service and they don't understand what we're doing or why we're talking about this or whatever. Well, because those things are secular to them. And here the magicians don't understand. Surprise, surprise. There's no answers there. And so Pharaoh is anxious. So what do you do when you're anxious? What do you do when you're anxious about your life? Are you like the rest of the world? You call the 1-900 number. Do you go down to the corner and talk to the lady who says, give me your palm. Let me read your palm. Let me look into the crystal ball. Let me look these things. Let me go to your sign, right? Whatever your sign might be. You look in the paper. Listen, don't go there. Why are we going there? Why are we participating there? Those things are not of God. Secondly, when discouraged, we should pray and seek the Lord for His word and answers. When discouraged or anxious, we should seek the Lord. And notice what Pharaoh does. Well, the cupbearer is reminded finally now after 2 years, oh, I remember back when I was in prison and when we were there and you were angry with us, Pharaoh. I remember that there was this Hebrew boy who was able to interpret dreams. And so they called Joseph. And Pharaoh sends and calls for Joseph, and they quickly bring him and they clean him up. They shave him. He probably had a great long beard. You can imagine how dirty he was being in prison for a couple of years. They changed his clothes and they brought him before Pharaoh. And Pharaoh says, I've had a dream. But I've heard, well, no one can interpret it, but I've heard, Joseph, that you can interpret it. I heard you can interpret it. So he calls for the one who can answer. Listen, you should go to the Word of God. Joseph is the one who represents the Word of God here. You should go to the Word of God for your answers. I love Philippians 4:4, right? Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Don't be anxious about anything. Verse 5, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And so you're to pray and seek the Lord. And then the last thing, and this is so important. I hope you get this one. Self-confidence is not good. Remember that you can't, but God can. Remember that you can't, but God can. Send for Joseph. By the way, when things are good, you don't typically send for others. But here they're bad, and so they send for Joseph. And they come, and Joseph, notice what he says to Pharaoh. Verse 16, Joseph answered to Pharaoh, underline this or circle it, put a star by it. It is not in me. God will give Pharaoh a favorable answer. You see, there is no place in the Christian life for self-confidence. No place in our lives for I can do it. I can do it on my own. In fact, Joseph comes and says to Pharaoh, oh, Pharaoh, I can't do this. Oh, well, you can't do it. You can't do it, Joseph. I heard you could interpret dreams. No, I can't do it. But let me tell you who can. God can. God can answer your dreams. He can interpret this. Is this not the key to peace? Listen, is this not the key to peace in the dungeon? Knowing I can't do it, but God can. I can't do it, but God can. Look to God alone. He's the one who can do it. Do what? He's the one who can heal your son or heal your daughter or give you a new job or change hearts or whatever or find flowers in a moment of need. He's the one who can do it. So I want you to do something with me this morning. I want you to repeat after me, okay? I want you to repeat this. Okay? Are you ready? I can't do it. But God can. That's it. I can't do it, but God can. And in the midst of your dungeon, in the midst of your difficulty, here's where the peace comes from. I can do nothing without God. It's impossible to do anything without God. Here's where peace comes from. Peace comes by learning to be patient. Secondly, peace comes by learning to be confident that God has a real plan for your life and the world for His glory, and God's working out all of these things. And I love it, don't you? Joseph says, look, God has a plan. He has a plan, Pharaoh, and I'm about to share it with you. So that leads to the third point, and we'll do this one quickly. Number three, peace comes by learning to be trusting. Trusting that God is going to orchestrate every detail according to His plan. Now, I just want to highlight a couple of things. He repeats the story, but did you notice at least two or three times Joseph tells Pharaoh, God has revealed to Pharaoh. Look at verse 25. God has revealed to Pharaoh what he's about to do. Verse 28, it is as I told you, Pharaoh. God has shown Pharaoh what he is about to do. Over in verse 32, the doubling of the dream means that the thing is fixed by God, and God will shortly bring it about. Wow. Something about Joseph has this incredible conviction that God has determined a plan for history. A plan not only for history, but for his own life, for God's glory, and for his good. And so he comes to trust in God. God, I don't know what you're doing, but I know you fixed this thing. You've provided these dreams, and you fixed it. So let me give you three things. These are brief. I'll give them to you brief. Number one, remember that our plans may not match up with God's plan. Is that okay with you? Is it okay that your plan doesn't necessarily match up with God's plan? But you're saying, God, I trust you. These things are fixed. I don't understand your ways. Sometimes they're mysterious. But I'm resting in you. I'm trusting in you. When North Korea speaks, I'm resting. I'm holding on to you. I don't have time to dive into this, but Isaiah chapter 45, I give it to you on your outline, is a great verse that describes who God is. God is the one who sits in the heavens. And he says, I am the Lord. There is none like me. Besides me, there is no God. There's no one like me. I equip you. Though you do not know me, that people may know that from the rising of the sun from the west, that there is none beside me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. And so we rest. We're trusting in God when your plans don't seem to come to place. Number two, rejoice that God wants to use you in his plan. I love the fact that God uses Joseph here. He uses Joseph. And can you imagine how Joseph's felt? Finally, after years, he rejoices that God is going to use him in his due time. And then last, be willing and be ready to do what God wants you to do in the midst of whatever door God opens for your life. Learning to trust God, no matter what circumstances come our way. So let me ask you this, do you have peace? Do you have this inner tranquility in your own heart? Are you able to look at the circumstances of your life and say, I know that God is able, and in His due time, He will do as He sees fit for His own glory. Instead of being troubled by life, we must put our hope in the Lord. And we can live a life of peace. Yes, even in the dungeon, we can live a life of peace, knowing that God is in control and that God is able. You see, this story is much more than a children's story. This story unfolds for us the incredible glory of our God. Do you know Him? Do you trust Him? Are you patient with Him? Patiently waiting on the Lord. Confident in what God can do. And trusting that God is going to work all things out for His glory. Bow your heads with me as we come to a close. I hope you know the Lord Jesus this morning. I hope you've put your personal trust in the Lord Jesus. If you don't know the Lord Jesus, you don't know the Father. Jesus said of Himself, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. If you know me, you know the Father. So I want to ask you this morning, do you know Christ Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Maybe you've never come to the place where you've repented of your sins and put your trust in Christ. We invite you to come and do that and put your faith in the Lord Jesus so that you can know how to interpret the things of life and that you'll have peace for your soul, knowing that your soul, when you die, you'll spend eternity with God in heaven. But even more than that, in this life, you can have peace with God. Maybe you're here this morning and you're a believer. You're really struggling. Your face is downcast. You don't know how to interpret the things that life has brought you, that God has brought you. Well, listen, be patient with the Lord. Be confident in the Lord. Be trusting in the Lord. And He'll give you peace. A peace that surpasses all understanding. Father in heaven, help us. We close this morning with this incredible story. And as we continue to look at the story week in, week out, Father, we pray that these great truths will become a fabric of our life. That we'll not be like the world who is in turmoil at every turn. Father, we'll be able to trust and hope and wait patiently on You. And that, Father, You'd give us a peace. A peace that will guard our minds and hearts in Christ Jesus. Help us, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thanks, Pastor Tim. Well, as that peace guards our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus, we also want to pray that He occupies our lonely hearts and that He owns everything and reigns supreme. So let's stand together and sing, O Great God, as we worship Him. Let's think on these words.
But in all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your paths. Amen?
Amen?
That's how we live our lives. And as you go out of this room today, God is sovereignly in control of all the details of our lives. Let us rest in Him. Let us be patient with Him, hoping in Him. And as you leave, there's a sign-up sheet for the outdoor service. So please sign up. You can either go online or you can sign up. Consider who could I bring to the outdoor service that they might hear the good news of Jesus. Start thinking about that in September. We're going to have a great time together. Let's make this a great event together, all right? Lord bless you. Have a great week. You're dismissed.